Hi, good evening, everybody. Thank you for being here. So today I'm going to talk about creating testability to achieve the continuous delivery. So today the theme of the talk is about learning. And it's a self-learning. So before I talk about learning, self-learning, I wanted to talk about myself. I'm Trisha Chetani. That is my picture. And this is all I know. How do I know all this stuff? I know because I've done some self-learning when I was a kid. So I got this opportunity at Vsense when I was actually, I got at 2016, and I relocated from India to Singapore. And Vsense was founded during 1st of August 2012. Do you know what kind of product Vsense use? Does anybody have any idea?
AI-based
products
for e-commerce.
Any other answer? That's good. Yeah. So it's actually we actually developed the visual search wherein people can take a picture and they can search online for a similar picture. So here, if you'll see the example, I'm actually clicking on the shoes, and then I'll try to detect that and I'll get the similar results online. So this was a product about. And they have a retailers like Rakuten, Asos, Chalera, Uniqlo. And here I'm not talking about the company, I'm actually talking about my personal experience. And we actually covered about mostly about the company, and we actually covered about the product. Now I wanted to talk about, like, I was a new member in the team, and I wanted to, like, the team started giving me the testing work. I don't know what to do. I was doing a lot of testing, or I was doing less testing, and they were not expecting that. So there was a problem. The problem was about disconnection in the team. Did you face any issues about disconnection in the team? Anybody had an experience?
Communication-wise, yes.
So what did you do?
We improved our communications.
Yeah. So similarly, we actually we started having a collaboration using a Scrum meetings, like stand-ups or retros or planning or something like, we started actually sitting next to each other. Then the next issue we faced was about the requirement was not clear, or the team were not aware of the test activities. And I need to actually, I need to help them to understand what are the test activities, or what kind of issues, like how do we solve that? So we came up with a release process, and our release process looks like something like this, wherein here it was a user story, and then we actually started with the requirement analysis, and the UX folks will come up with the design specifications, and the dev will implement their code, and DevOps team will help us with the clean test environment. Simultaneously, I'll come up with a test plan or test data or any environment, test environment support from the testing perspective. Then the real challenge comes when they actually wanted to merge the local change to the mainline repository. So they need to actually pass all this test, unit test, minimum acceptance criteria, or successfully running the whatever the existing automated test, which was actually written by the developers, and fix all the static code analysis issues. Then the process was like from developer to QA environment. They need to merge all the code, and they need to run all the details codes. After that, it was like from the QA environment, we need to run the test, and we need to actually make sure we have done some exploratory testing, and the test results are being shared. And then the PM will help with the UAD test, and then we actually update the dependencies, and that's how we release the software. And so, but I was still new to the team, and I was not knowing about the technology they are using. They were using about they were using Jenkins, they were using Docker, they were using JavaScript, they were using Protector, and I was completely new. So I need to learn about all this technology because my previous experience was with a company wherein they were having their own tech stacks. So now the next challenge come, they actually won't expect me to become a test master. They wanted me to actually handle all the E2E tests and make all the UI tests run green, faster, and stable. So the first challenge was like, we need to actually agree on the E2E test flow with the team. So how did you folks actually came up with the E2E test flow? It was not a test case. Do you have any strategy around that? So what we did is we actually started coming from E2E test flow based on the analytics or based on the either analytics or what is the important features, or it could be a business critical flow. We started coming from there, and now the next challenge was to understand what is the existing test flow which was written by the developers. So the first impression was like the test execution time was taking 30 minutes, and the occurrence of the faulty test was actually multiplied. And comparing to any other job, it was ridiculously slow. And team was not having any confidence on the existing checks. So what should I do? Because and the occurrence of faulty test was because of the undeterministic behavior of the application, or it could be a caching, it could be a page load time, or it could be a third-party faulty code they were using. So how to make the test stable? What do you folks have done to actually make the test stable? If you were in my place, what you would have done? Yeah, so I started my investigation and I found few of this. I actually separated into environment change, coding changes, debugging changes, framework changes, of there was a knowledge silos. So from the coding perspective, I found like from the locator perspective, we should use the ID, not the XPath, because ID makes it more reliable, more faster than XPath, and we should minimize using the locators. From the assertion perspective, I found like we should actually use the assertion at the test file, not at the page file. And assertion should be a soft assertion, not the hard assertion, because if you are using the hard assertion, it will actually stop the test execution over there. And from the weight perspective, I actually found the implicit and explicit weight was not working. The fluent weight was working over here. And we started writing the small and independent test. Even we started including something like we wanted to name our test wisely. We wanted to have more of logs, comments, and we started avoiding complex logic over here. The next was a debugging. For any investigation of the failure, the screenshot was more important. And we implemented retry logic, and even we actually had the JavaScript console errors for us to investigate what kind of JavaScript errors are there, and the team were helping me to fix that. The test reports, we actually started using the libraries which had a lot of integrated test reports, where it was giving a detailed overview of JavaScript errors, even the screenshots, and it was very easy to integrate some of those libraries. From the framework perspective, our team was the front-end application was based on the Angular, so we were using a Protector, which was good, and I found the flexibility of configuration of test was very important, because it will help us to remove and add whenever, and it whenever required, based on the impacted area. And the community support was something important because we can actually look for the experienced users over there, and we can actually, and what is the frequency of updates, and how to salute some of the situations, and the most important is, does it supports our use case? What is our use case? What kind of problem we are actually trying to solve? Does it support that? Does the tool support that? From the environment perspective, I started using Docker because Docker, you can run your test in the isolation, and Selenium Grid will give the parallel running. And we started using the clean test environment, and the most important was, like, our test environment was not in sync with the production environment always, because we were using, so we had to make that configuration saying that our test environment will be always in sync with the production environment. And some of the other issues like network, CPU, sometimes the network was not there. Because of that, we are not able to see the page on the browser. So those we were opening in parallel, and it was causing our memory issues. So those kind of other issues were there, which we were trying to solve. And we also need to actually look, pair up with the developers to identify where we should write that test. Because if they are covering those kind of tests in the unit level or integration level, then we don't need to actually write at the UI level. So it's really good to pair up with the developers. So we worked as a team. Our team doesn't have a habit of making our pipeline always as a green. So now after this, when we are trying to solve, we always made sure that everybody takes our responsibility to make our pipeline green. And we started committing our code in the afternoon, not at the evening when everybody is leaving. And we started updating our automation test. If it is like 6 months old, then we started removing it if it is not a higher priority. Because we assume saying that it's actually the code is stable over there and there is no further changes. And we started having a monitoring over there in our test cases, and everybody in the team started giving the feedback how to improve the test, and they started giving a lot of ideas over here. So as a result, we achieved the test execution time within 5 minutes, which was a huge success for us because it gave me alone as a time to do some other learning. I could actually spend my time on understanding the tech stacks in the deeper level. Currently, I was just focused on the UI level. Now, I could actually go and understand what are the API they are consuming, and I can write the test around those. And I can further investigate what kind of problem is there in the product. And it also gave us an opportunity where we could write a wiki page, or we could share with the different team what was the problem and how did we solve it. So there was a team contribution also, because the developer helped me to optimize the page load time, or whatever the uncertainty was there inside the application, they helped me to solve, or they were using the faulty test, third-party code, they actually removed that, and they started getting the good libraries which can be used over there. And the team also helped me to do the RCA of the automation code. They also helped me to prioritize and maintaining the test code, and team also helped me to review the test code. Root cause analysis. So currently, I actually saw this video from the Richard Bratza, and he was talking in the SauceLab conference, wherein he was talking, the testability is the foundation of all the test efforts. Whatever we do, that we should actually think about the testability. And he was talking about the team. He made this triangle, and he was saying, whenever we actually define our test automation strategy, we need to think about the team, project, product, technology, stakeholder, infrastructure. Those are the more very important point. Like, let's say inside the team, if we don't have a skill, and we usually hire only for the people who have expertise in Selenium. we don't look for the people who are expertise in other fields. But when we develop a product, we need the people from a different skills. So we need to actually consider what is our team doesn't have, and we need to educate ourselves. And from the project perspective, like let's say sometimes they will actually start coming up with a small project, and even though they have not started, but we will start looking for the framework over there. So even though they have not decided what kind of application code or application framework they are going to decide, but we are coming up with the test framework, which is not good. Then he also talked about the product product context, wherein he mentioned we need to like somebody let's say somebody's managers come and say you just need to automate, but you really don't know what is the real problem, why you wanted to automate. But because when we are actually automating, we are actually we are also spending the money over there. What is the real use of automating? Can't we do the manual testing if it is a very small project? Because it requires extra efforts over there, extra money over there. So he was coming from there. He was saying like we need to really understand our product, and what kind of product it is. Is it like a UI, API, or IoT? What kind of product it is, and what kind of automation test we can actually write over there. Then he talked about the technology, wherein he mentioned we need to look inside our application and the deeper level, like what kind of test will be implemented at the unit test or the API test or at the integration test or at the UI test. Then he mentioned about the stakeholders. Stakeholders just hear from somebody saying that we need to automate for the sake of automating. But they really don't know like why we need to automate, why what kind of test we also need to do. They don't understand that. So we need to have a real communication around that. From the infrastructure context, he mentioned about like we really need to understand are we having access to the different environment, different pipelines. Mostly when we actually try to get this access, it will be like if you're asking today, it will become a Christmas. So first we need to understand those, and then if we start automating, it will whatever the test automation we are building, it will be really nice. So I wanted to leave you with the takeaway as continuous learning and not being at knowledge silos within the team, or have a teamwork, pair with each other, understand the context before start automating. It will really help you to like automate it better. If you just automate for the sake of somebody saying automate it, it doesn't make sense. I would actually I would actually thank you everyone to be in this talk, and I would expect any questions and answers that will help me to give a chance of learning from you. It was a flow, and we were running around it was a complete end-to-end flow, and we were running around 40-50 desk full of flows. Yeah, it was a flow, like what can a super user can do, what can an administrator can do, what a normal users can do. We were using the AWS, and it was running inside Docker. Any other questions?
If you monitor, then it's okay. But over a period of time, how do you keep track of the flaky test, and how do you?
It's like every day in the evening, you wanted to go, and somebody will come and say, "Okay, you need to look into this environment because it's your test case is failing, and you need to spend time every day fixing the same test cases." And you will be fixing the same test cases over a month or over a week. Then you will really understand, okay, this is flaky because I fixed it. Somebody have changed the locator, or somebody have actually updated something, or either it, application was not, the page load was not there. That's why the test was failing. I was not able to identify the locators. Any other questions? I'm not able to get.
Are you using APM for your?
I was using Protector.
So it's something similar. That means there's a server running, talking to your client, test client. So the friend test come about is because of this server reacting slowly to the request.
Right? Yeah, it's come because of the application. Application it's like what happens in the Selenium. Selenium you are sending a request to identify certain elements on the page and it's not finding that element. That's where your test will be failing. Either it's not synchronized with the application code, either it's showing you an undeterministic behavior, or it's not finding the locators, some of those. It will keep polling for looking that elements on the page, web page.
This is actually the cost of all these tests.
Yeah.
How do you prepare the production like data from your test environments? So let's say it's like when you build, you automatically sync.
I didn't mention production like data. I mentioned we need to use a production environment as similar as test environment. It should not be like your production environment as having 2-3 servers and your test environment as just running on one server. It should be exactly same as what is your production environment.
My experience with end-to-end test with APM server, things like that, right, is very slow. So I was thinking if we want to do it on a nightly or daily basis, we should go more for the API testing, for example. Not this kind of UI automation. Maybe this one will be used for less accidentally test where you have less test cases to run. If you want to cover more, have a better test coverage, and you want to run it on a regular daily basis, you should go more for the API level.
Yeah, it depends what do you.
So you don't have face all these ranking test issues.
It depends on what kind of automation you wanted to do, because let's say if you're covering everything, tests are already there on the unit test and integration test, then it doesn't make sense because you should not write the same code. You need to talk to your developer what kind of tests they are already writing and you should not write those. Like let's say text validation, all the error messages, or a lot of this kind of tests will be actually covered at the unit test or integration test. So you should not write. You should actually focus on the UI layer. When you need to check what is the user is doing. As a user, are you able to click on the button? You are able to find on the button. You are able to find the button. It depends, like what kind of risk you are able to eliminate over there. That's a major focus should be there from the UI perspective. Like if you are actually using the visual testing, which you were asking me certain time before, like you are thinking as a risk, like saying that is the page is having all the particular elements. So you're eliminating the risk of having the pages actually loaded with the right alignment of the button. But the button is actually displaying vertically, it's not displaying horizontally.
So you're saying this, all this should be done at the unit level?
It depends on what kind of risk and which level. Like you need to talk to your developer and find out what test they are writing and what kind of risk you are eliminating. You need to think from in terms of the risk. Any other questions? Thank you.